Can everyone find their seat? We'll get started here. If we can have the candidates come forward. The second debate for tonight for District 5 Board of Education. And Wilkins is going to continue to moderate tonight's debate for this one. And as the candidates are drawing to figure out which one's going first, just right quick, make another announcement that we have our last debate for this week. On Wednesday the 27th, the first one starting at 5:30. It's a earlier time for the coroner debate. And then at 7 p.m., the sheriff's debate back here in the same room. So mark that on your calendar for Wednesday, April 27th. So tonight for Board of Education District 5, we have Mr. Kevin Foley, Mr. Mike Tasos, and Board of Education member Nancy Roche. And I'm going to turn it over to Brad for the questions.
Thank you very much, everyone. Before the debate began, we drew numbers. The person who drew to go first was Nancy Roche, followed by Mike Tasos, and then Kevin Foley. When we get to the closing statements, we'll reverse order, and Mr. Foley will go first. Does everybody know how to use the mics? Red is off, clear is on. Everyone has 2 minutes for a question, 1 minute for rebuttal in the beginning. I'll remind folks about rebuttals as we get further into the debate. I'll stop reminding you if you want a rebuttal or rebuttal, just ask me or just nod, and we'll have one. So, our opening statements begin with Nancy Roche.
Good evening. I too want to thank the Republican Party this evening for hosting this event. My name is Nancy Roche, and I'm the incumbent for the Board of Education, District Number 5. I'm seeking this re-election because I really feel that serving on the Board of Education, I can give back to my community in a very meaningful way. I have a passion for education, and I was on the board when we developed our mission and vision of quality learning and superior performance for all. And I'm very proud to say that it's still very relevant to this day. I believe that my vision, my experience, and my proven leadership were instrumental in this success on our board, and it helped to create the world-class system that we are today. Forsyth County schools have a 94% graduation rate, and we have the lowest millage rate per pupil cost in the metro Atlanta area. I think that's a very excellent combination, and families are truly getting a good return on investment in Forsyth County. When I started on the board in 2001, we only had around 15,000 students. This fall, we are expecting over 46,000. We are currently constructing 3 new schools, an elementary, a middle, and a high, and we're renovating 16 schools, thanks to the community passing our last bond referendum. We've had some challenging years with the economy going down and having to raise the millage rate, but we also had austerity cuts of $158 million that were held back in our QBE funding over the years. So it's been very challenging, but I hope to convince you in the next hour that I am the right first person to elect to keep going forward with the future challenges of our school system. Thank you.
Our next opening statement will go to Mr. Tasos.
Thank you. My name is Mike Tasos, and I'm a longtime resident of Forsyth County. Lived here since 1994. To borrow from Louis Brizard, I consider myself an American by birth, Southerner by the grace of God. I grew up in Bakersfield, California, and like I said, lived here since 94, have 2 children, and one of them is a freshman at UGA, and the other one is a freshman at Forsyth Central High School. Nancy, I gotta praise you for your service and for as long as you've been here in the board. 2001 is a long time. But I know there was a book that came out not too long ago about everything I learned in kindergarten. And I think one of the things I remember from that is the importance of sharing, the importance of giving others a chance. And I think one of the things that's so frustrating as a longtime resident is being intimidated by incumbents. Being incumbent and not wanting to get involved because you figure, I can't win. Well, I'm almost 61 years old. I figure if I'm going to do this, it's time to do it now. I have some ideas. I think new blood, fresh ideas. And I think one of the things is, I believe if you don't like change, just go to a vending machine. So I think one of the things we need to do is take a look at giving someone else a chance. And Nancy, that's not to say that, you know, you haven't done outstanding things and brought this board a long way. But I also have a problem with politicians, and I'm not a politician. One of the things that I want to affect some change, but I think one of the things that scares politicians worse is the term limits. And I think there needs to be, give somebody else a chance. Thank you.
And the next opening statement goes to Mr. Foley.
Hey, thanks, Brad. Once again, my name's Kevin Foley. I grew up in Tennessee. I've been in Georgia since 02, and I've been here in Forsyth County since 09. The background I bring is that I spent 10 years as a classroom teacher and a coach, so I've seen firsthand what goes on in the classroom. So when it comes to saying, okay, this is how we want to do things in the county, I know what the impact is, what it does for a teacher and student morale. What I aim to do in office is be a line of communication between the Board of Education and the Board of Commissioners with all these out-of-control growth we're having. Also, too, you know, from my experience as a classroom teacher, we've had all these other, these extra tasks we've had to do, administrative duties. I want to get rid of some of that, let teachers focus on teaching. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Just a reminder to all the debate participants that our timekeeper is sitting in the front. When you see the red card, please wrap it up, and I will cut time when we get to that point. Our first question will go to Mr. Tasos. The first question is, how would you approach the issue of rapid development in the county, and what would you propose as the best possible solutions to increasing crowded, solutions to increasing crowded schools?
Well, I think one of the things that when we look at overcrowding, we look at what's the alternative. And I think one of the things that we have to do in order to help with overcrowding is we have to be more effective. I'm in the pharmaceutical business and been in a long time, and I know one of the things, you have to be effective or you're gonna fall behind. And one of the things we want to do is look at how we can be more effective. So what's the answer to overcrowding? I think we could poll everyone in this audience and we could get a bunch of different answers. I think one of the things we need to look at, I think there's empowerment of the teachers, empowerment of the schools. And one of the things that we haven't done, I think we get hung up in, instead of being productive, we get hung up in the process. And my goal would be to figure out how we can be more productive. Answers to that? No. I've never run for a political office in my life. But you know what? I think we always have to start something new. And one of the things I can do, I think I can absorb and use the members of the board who use their experience and to make us more effective. And that's one of the things I want to do. Thank you.
Mr. Foley?
And can you repeat your question one more time?
Sure. How would you approach the issue of rapid development in the county, and what would you propose as the best possible solutions to increasing crowded schools?
Okay. Well, what I would do is communicate with the Board of Commissioners, because I think what happens a lot of times is that they approve all the zoning, but they're not thinking about the impact that it has after the building has occurred. So as a result, you have all these overcrowded schools. In fact, one of the elementary schools that they're opening this year is already 116% capacity. So I would communicate with the Board of Commissioners to say, hey, these districts have out of control growth. Let's stop this development here in these particular areas.
And the question goes now to Nancy Roche.
I think it might be real easy to say that we could stop the development, but if I think it's a misconception that we have not been working with the commissioners, because as Tom said earlier, I think it's the same people in the group today, that we actually give them by each and every zoning. We tell them how many kids it's going to generate at the elementary school, at the middle school, at the high school level. We tell them what school they will be going to. We tell them the percentage it is overcrowded, say it's 120%. We tell them if there is going to be another school on the horizon, such as Brandywine. If there's not a school on the horizon, we tell them, is there land available? Is there money available? Is the funding there for it? So we personally don't work maybe as a board and commissioners. You don't see us in meetings together in the newspaper and everything, but our board chair and vice chair, they meet with them, each other, and our central office people, our facilities people go to all the meetings and they keep up with all this data. And it's the data that we give to the commissioners to use. The thing is, we can give them all that data, but we cannot make them, you know, use that data on a daily basis and to make an informed decision. So it's frustrating for us also that they aren't using that information that we give them, like I say, on every single zoning that comes out there.
Are there any rebuttals?
Yes, I'd like to just say about the, Mike mentioned the empowerment of the principals and the teachers. We are very, very strong about giving our principals, definitely giving the autonomy of their school and the empowerment to make the right decisions in each and every school. So I feel that I think you can ask any principal that we really do have that empowerment already.
That's the first time I've ever seen somebody rebut themselves. Probably about twice. I think one of the things as far as empowering the teachers and empowering, it goes to the fact that education to me, and like I said, I've never been a teacher, I've been a substitute teacher, I've read the classes, I've been a coach for many years in the community. I think we need to do something with our teachers. I don't know what the amount is, but it's a ridiculous amount that the teachers get to make their classrooms stronger. We need to look at that, and that's one of the ways I would propose to improve empowerment.
Any rebuttals, Mr. Foley? Seeing none, we'll move on to the next question. Next question will start with Mr. Foley. What are your thoughts on parental choice, and would you support a parental choice educational system?
Absolutely. Tell you my background. I went to public school K through 8 up in Tennessee, and then I went to a Catholic high school. And so I'm not going to take something for myself and then turn around and tell someone else that they can't have it. So whether the parents want to send their kids to the public schools, to a charter school, parochial, private, homeschool, I'm all about that.
And the question will roll around to Ms. Roche.
As far as parental choice going, as far as if you want to go to a private school or a charter school, whatever, I certainly support that. I think within our public school system, especially in the overcrowded situation that we are, it's almost impossible. We do have the choice at the high school level. Say if you want to go into the healthcare system and you apply to Lambert, we have the STEM Academy at Forsyth Central, we have cosmetology at certain schools, and you can apply for those programs and either be accepted or not. We have IB at South. Obviously, that is a parental choice to get that program. But at elementary and middle school, no, we do not have that choice unless the school has openings, which I think, again, in the fast-growing community, it's the best that we can do as far as the parental choice goes.
And the question goes to Mr. Tasos. Same question.
Nancy, I agree with you. I think that one of the things that we do have here in Forsyth County is parental choice when it comes to high school. I have a son who graduated from South in the IB program, and it prepared him. He did work that I don't think I even did in college. I mean, it's outstanding the way that program worked. And he is absolutely excelling, and I'm proud of him. I think that one of the things that we need to do, again, we start talking about empowerment. I think if we have a school where a parent does not want to send their kids to that school or wants to go to another school, figure out a way to work within the system and try to get that school a better situation.
And the first rebuttal would go to Mr. Foley. Your rebuttal. Ms. Roche. Mr. Casas, any rebuttal?
No, thank you.
Moving on to the next question, which we'll start with Ms. Roche.
Do you feel the current school calendar has improved learning retention, or should adjustments be made to return to a more classic American school calendar from previous decades?
I think it has definitely improved student achievement starting earlier. What we do is we go to the local school councils at each school, and we see what they want. It's not set by the board, because we say this is what we want, and this is the calendar, and this is what's going to be. We've done that over the years. In fact, like 2 years ago, we had a few schools that wanted the whole week off in the fall. Well, there's some schools that did not want that, but once we got to the fact that there was only about four schools that didn't really like that idea, we decided to try it, and it worked real well. There are still some people that do not like that, and I hear that some. I think a lot of it's some poor-income families, and they can't go off to Disney World or go to some certain places that some of the families can do. But I definitely think it has, and if you figure out our calendar, you can no longer start after Labor Day. I grew up in Minnesota, and we started after Labor Day, and we ended, by Memorial Day. But we also didn't have spring break because it was real cold, and we didn't have the money to go to Florida or go anywhere else, so we didn't have a spring break at all. We had a very short Christmas vacation. So if you look at the 180 days and you try and fit them in, I did this for the legislature when they were trying to move the calendar out and not start as early in August, and it really just numerically doesn't work out. Thank you.
Question rolls to Mr. Foley.
Well, to tell you the truth, I'm really not familiar with the calendar the way it is now, but it's something I'll certainly study up on.
And Mr. Tasos, same way.
Well, I think one of the things that, when asked, it's one of the big issues, and I find it to be the calendar. I'm sure everybody in the room is aware that school will start August 4th this next year. And I personally find that ridiculous. I think having a fall break, talked about lower income families, not just them. I mean, it benefits some administrators. It's really hard to break up a school year with a fall break. And somebody said, I've heard the argument for it, is that you have to end the school year, the school first semester, by Christmas. Says who? Why do you have to end it before Christmas? Why not start it a more traditional? I grew up the same way, Nancy. We started school right after Labor Day. Jimmy Buffett says, my goal is to keep summer alive for as long as possible. Summer's a great time for kids, and I think it should be a great time for families. And fall break now, to me, is a nuisance. It really is. And I have not talked to many parents who say, all right, fall break. It's just something that's been forced down the parents' throat. And the calendar, when you take a look at it, it's more or less like year-round school. And I don't know of any parents who think that that's a good idea. And I think I am really passionate about this, and I've written about it, and I think that we need to make sure the parents get more empowered, the students get more empowered to have a reasonable summer vacation and a reasonable school year. Thank you.
The first rebuttal would go to Ms. Roche.
Yes, the reason we do end before Christmas with the first semester is that we partner with a lot of the local colleges and technical schools, and that's what their calendar is, and that is pretty much the reason why we do that. And also the empowerment, every school has an LSC, so if you want to be empowered, you need to, as a parent, run for the LSC, get involved in your local school, and express that opinion, because truthfully, we go out every single year with the calendar, and what are your ideas, and this is the sample of what it might be, and the criticism will come back to us.
And the next rebuttal goes to Mr. Foley. And the final rebuttal goes to Mr. Tasos.
And I think that's noble that you have an LSC and people are able to provide input. But just like tonight, the audience here, this is an opportunity for people to meet the candidates. It's something that's very crucial to the county, yet the hole is not filled. And I think people are apathetic for whatever reason. Maybe if they figure they don't have a voice. But I think one of the things we have to do is make sure that other people see that they do have a voice and say, wait a minute, we have a fall break and I have to pay for it. My son's in elementary school, my daughter, and I have to pay for a sitter for a week and school just started. I don't think that's good business, for lack of a better word.
All right, the next question We'll start with Mr. Tasos. It's a long one, so I'm going to read it, and if I have to read it a second time, let me know. Georgia has developed an excellent technical college system. Given the fact that the job market is trending towards more automation, are we properly preparing our students for STEM careers and academic studies? Should there be more investment in technical and vocational training in middle and high schools?
Well, that's an interesting question, in that I think the fact is that not everybody is college bound when they leave a high school. So what can we do? I think we have to handle that on a case by case or school by school basis. Like I said, my son goes to Central. He's not involved in STEM, but I know there's all kinds of programs. They have an automotive program. They have, I think, a cosmetology program. The fact is, not everybody is going to be a college student, and not everybody is going to excel in college. But I think we, as parents and as stewards of our kids' future, we need to be able to adjust. And if we need to make more of an effort towards vocational education, by golly, we should do that.
Question goes to Mr. Foley. Same question.
Yeah, I do agree with Mr. Tasos. I think all too often, the policies that come from above national and state level, they operate under the assumption that all kids are going to go to college, and everything should be college prep. But yeah, we do need to have a college track and also a career or technical track, as was described. Like Germany and Japan, for instance, that's exactly what they do. One curriculum for people going to college, others that want to study for a career. We need to do more of that in our schools, I think.
And the question goes, rolls around to Ms. Roche. Same question.
Again, I agree with the two gentlemen with all the programs that we have in the high schools, but we also have a new school that we're hoping to open in 2018, weather permitting, and that is our Alliance for Academy for Innovation, which truthfully falls right into this category. We're going to have aeronautics, we're going to be working, hopefully, this is this community-based program. The community looked, we met with businessmen and businesswomen and said, what do you need as a community? How do you need these kids to graduate from our schools so they can be career ready, whether it's going on to a technical school or possibly getting a job right away? We hope to work with the sheriff's department, the fire department. We're working with already working with North Forsyth Hospital. That's that program is in Lambert because we were there recently, and a gal comes in and she's got three young gals with her, and she said, oh, by the way, I'm the teacher from Lambert. Is it okay if we come in and watch? So we've got some excellent partnerships. We can continue those partnerships. Again, hospitality and tourism, megatronics, energy systems. There's so many things that are going to be going into this brand new school. It's just really exciting for us because we too feel that we should be reaching out and giving these kids the opportunities they need to go out into the world and be career ready. Thank you.
Given that everybody said they agreed and the amount of time that we have left and the number of questions, I'm going to skip rebuttals. Next question, we'll go to Mr. Foley first. What is your view of the Common Core standards adopted by Georgia? What policy or policies do you support? What policy or policies do you think should be abandoned?
Well, as far as Common Core, all I know is when I was in the classroom, No Child Left Behind was the big thing when I was teaching. And programs like that, it just creates too much paperwork, too much testing. So stuff, top-down stuff like that, we need to do away with. Let the teachers focus on teaching. Let the teachers and the parents have more input in what the curriculum is going to be.
Question rolls around to Ms. Roche.
Would you just repeat the question quickly?
Sure.
Just the details?
Sure. What is your view of the Common Core standards adopted by Georgia? What policy or policies do you support? What policy or policies do you think should be abandoned?
Truly, I support the fact that we need to have standards. I feel like, especially in our growing community, if you're in third grade at one school and you get redistricted to third grade at another school, you need to be on the same standards. We need to know that our children graduate third grade or fifth grade or whatever grade it is, and then they can move to another school and still have those same standards. I think, again, there's a lot of misconceptions. The Common Core was developed Georgia was very involved in that, starting back in 2010, and was very key and instrumental in developing Common Core. We now changed the name in Georgia. It's Georgia Standards of Excellence, the GSE. And we've also, we are not associated with the national level in many areas. For example, we don't use their testing. It was very, very expensive, so we do our own testing. And I think if you look at it, if you look at the data, you'll see that test scores have improved across Georgia. And if you ask most teachers, I would say, they would say, please, first of all, you have to have a curriculum, but please don't change it again. Don't keep changing it. We want continuous improvement, and I think you have to have continuous improvement by not continuously changing the curriculum for these teachers and for these students. Thank you.
And the question goes to Mr. Tasos.
Well, I visited this issue and read and studied, and I guess Common Core confuses me. I've watched a video, I don't know how many times, of somebody saying, what's 7 plus 4? It's 10. I mean, and you can look on the internet, and it seems to me like it's nonsense. And I believe in progress, and I think we need to move forward. But one other thing that I really feel that we've done is done a disservice. And anybody here can explain to me how you get an equation and, it's what we don't know. We want to have somebody be able to, come up with an answer because they thought, no, I'm sorry, 7 plus 4 is 11. 7 plus 4 will always be 11. And as a manager, as a sales manager, numbers are what I look at. We live and die by the numbers in my industry. And people are promoted and people are compensated over the numbers. Let's take a look at teaching kids the way that, what they need to learn. They're going to go to college, they're going to get in business, and they come to a boss and say, 7 plus 4 is 10. I don't know. They might be shown the door. Thank you.
The first rebuttal goes to Mr. Foley.
Okay, yeah, I agree totally with what Mr. Tasso said. And just to clarify something I was saying earlier about having parents and teachers have more input in the curriculum, but yeah, do that within the confines of a set of standards.
And the next rebuttal would go to Ms. Roche. Mr. Tasso? The next question. We'll go to Ms. Roche. Question is, what would be the best and most appropriate metric or metrics for teacher evaluations?
At this time, we already have the TEKS, which is our teacher evaluation system. And we've been working with our state legislators and the State Board of Education saying that it needs to be looked at, because I think too much emphasis was put on the test scores of the students in the classroom. They changed some of that. They had a bill and they're actually having less testing. They've also changed the evaluation methods, so they're looking more at the professional development of the teacher rather than just criticizing because your students didn't excel as they should. It's a very difficult situation because, unfortunately, politics will probably get involved because you may say you want the best kids in the class, but what if all your kids have 98s? You guys still have to make them improve. If the teachers are evaluated on improvement, once you're at 98, it's hard to improve to 99 and 100. So you may actually want a lower level class. So you can take them from the 60s and 70s up to the 80s or 90s. So like I say, it becomes very political within each building. I don't like that. I don't know the answer to all the teacher evaluations, but I think if you ask the kids, especially at the high school level, they can tell you the good teachers, the bad teachers. They can tell you who they're learning from and who they're not learning from. And I think that's the important thing. But to me, professional development is the key, because what we need to do, we need to strive for, is hiring good teachers. But we think we need to continue to develop them, on a yearly basis to make sure that all the students have quality teachers in their classroom, because that's obviously how we're going to be successful as a school system if all our kids can succeed.
And the question rolls around to Mr. Foley. What would be the best and most appropriate metric or metrics or teacher evaluations.
I agree with Ms. Roche. I don't think there's really one perfect way of evaluating. I certainly wouldn't do test scores as a means. Reason being, you know, some kids just don't test well. I've been in classes where, you know, the kids just don't care. So, you know, so if you're going to evaluate a teacher on test scores, you know, that's really not a fair way to do it. Especially if teacher A has one set of kids and teacher B has a whole other set of kids that are totally different, yeah, there needs to be some, I don't know, have the perfect answer either, so.
And the answer, or the question now goes to Mr. Tasos.
Yeah, it's funny, we were having this discussion at home last night, my son talking about his being in elementary school and how a teacher he had really, really cast a shadow over the whole school year. And, you know, I think one of the things that I'm happy to say, and the other teachers in the fifth grade, there were some awesome ones. And my wife and I had a discussion about, boy, we should have taken him out of there. But you know what? One of the things that I noticed, after 1 or maybe 2 years, that teacher was gone. And she inherently had problems with parents and students. So I think one of the keys is, and as a manager, I've had to hire and recruit. I think one of the things, we get good principals in there who know how to evaluate their teachers. I mean, I think we all know if somebody's a quote, bad teacher, we know what that is. I'm sure a principal will know what that is. But you know what, and yes, it is difficult to do. But I think one of the things we have to do is we have to use good judgment when we're hiring principals so they can go ahead and hire good teachers. And then, you know, by golly, have an opportunity to make changes if they have to. Changes in the classroom, try to develop that teacher, make them better within the system. If not, they can find another career. I mean, as simple as that, if they don't want to develop and improve.
Any rebuttal to Ms. Brush? Mr. Coleman? Mr. Tasos? Any rebuttals? Okay. Next question will go to, starting with Mr. Tasos. What is the actual value of the extensive testing of our students, particularly our very young elementary students?
I'm not sure of the value, especially when you're talking very young students, because it seems like, and this is something that was very recent for us. I guess they used to be called CRCT, right? I mean, that's what they were. And it seemed like the entire focus of the school year was to get kids ready to pass the test. And it seemed like a lot of learning went by the wayside. And that's simply not good. So I'm not sure the value of standardized testing like that for very young kids. I think one of the things we want to do, again, let's evaluate, find a way to evaluate how there's been improvement, how there's been development, how we've challenged our students to want to get better. All right. I mean, I don't think we want saying, okay, look, you have to learn this so you pass the test. Put some value on the knowledge they're getting instead of saying, all right, here's what you got to do. You got to pass the test. If not, there's consequence.
Next, the question goes to Mr. Foley. What is the actual value of the extensive testing of our students, particularly our very young elementary students?
None. We're just over testing these kids, especially at a younger age. And I just know in the springtime, it takes away at least a week of instruction time. And parents I've talked to are complaining about how there's academic work in kindergarten, and their kindergartens are now having to prepare for tests, and it's just taking a toll on them. I mean, I don't remember having any academic work in kindergarten. I came out okay, I think. I would say wait till at least the middle grades do any sort of standardized testing, but keep it at a minimum.
Question rolls to Ms. Roche.
Again, I found some of the data, and the state testing is actually going down from 32 state tests to 24 state tests. So maybe we're on the right track anyway. But I agree with the gentleman that at the very, very young age, the testing is very, very hard on them. They don't understand it a lot of times. But I know on a day-to-day basis, I hear the stories now, but now the parents get frustrated because they say, well, they get to take the test over and over and over until they make up until the 90s, and they say, well, that's not right either. And I keep trying to stress, especially at the lower levels, it's not the 90 or the 100 or the 80 that they got on the test. It's, yes, take it over, do whatever until you learn the material. But again, the basic thing is, let's teach these kids, not let's not just write down their first score. It's like, oh, well, they didn't learn that, let's move on. If they didn't learn how to add, they're never gonna learn how to subtract. If they didn't learn those, they're never gonna learn how to multiply and divide. So you've got to make sure that that basic knowledge base is there as you go along. Again, testing actually gives, it's, you know, it's using the data, it's positioning these children of, you know, what grade level do they need to be in? Are they ready to move on to fourth grade? So again, I think some testing is actually necessary to give us some milestones and you know, exactly where are these children? We just can't depend on a teacher saying, yes, you know, Joey's okay, but Sally's not. So I guess, I mean, everybody wants some data written down. Parents, again, I think would demand something that they have the 1, 2, 3 or the ABC or the 90 or the 80 or the 70. So I think there's a happy medium. I don't think we need as many, but I think some testing is absolutely necessary.
And the first rebuttal will go to Mr. Tasos.
I believe that one of the things that testing can accomplish is that we can see how the children have developed over the course of the school year, and then make adjustments based upon that. I remember the basic Iowa test that we used to take, and you were either, I remember in third grade, I was in ninth grade level at something. I said I was? No, I don't think I was all that good. And you know, I think one of the things you want to do is get these students to develop and develop how to think in a concept. Thank you.
Next rebuttal will go to Mr. Foley. Ms. Roche? Moving on to the next question, it will start with Mr. Foley, somewhat tangentially related to what we just asked. What is the role of recess in the school day, and how can recess help to alleviate student and teacher stress during testing periods?
It's really more of a mental break than anything. I mean, when you're constantly in the classroom, what, 6-7 hours a day, something like that, yeah, it does take a toll on you mentally. And I mean, there's that learning curve. I don't know if anybody's seen, but it's like this illustrated here. But say, like, you got a continuum of time right here, and once you retain here at the beginning, it kind of goes down as you go along, and then it's back up. So it's almost like you remember the first and last things that you read when doing an assignment. And so things like recess and lunch and all that actually helps break up that period of time. So yeah, I think things like recess, music class, all that, I believe, given that helps with student retention.
Question rolls to Ms. Roche.
I agree. I truly believe that recess is a valuable part of the day, and especially when they started taking it away maybe from fourth graders and fifth graders, because there's so much to teach these kids. But again, I think having that break, even if it's only for 15 minutes, gives those kids a break from the learning, and they can come back refreshed. And again, during testing time, I'm hoping that they're spreading out the tests and there is some time to, you know, even if they just stand up and walk around the room or walk up and down the hall, even just so they get breaks and everything. But I think recess can be very, very valuable too, because we want to create well-rounded children. They learn a lot on the playground. They learn how to get along with other people. You know, there's a lot, like I say, that you can teach children on the playground and not just running around and just having a good time, but like I say, constructive ideas.
And Mr. Tasos?
Yeah, I agree with the importance of recess, and more along with the break and along with being able to let the kids get and run around the playground. You know, I had this conversation with my oldest son about what he's going to learn in college. And he's going to learn a lot in the books. He's going to learn a lot managing his money, managing his time. And those are things that are valuable. But one of the other things you have to learn when you go away to school is you have to learn the social, how to socialize. And I think that's one of the things that's so important, because I'll tell you, I graduated from college in 1977, and I still have friends that I talk to now who graduated with me. But by golly, I don't think I remember a whole lot that I learned, and I got good grades. But you know, the importance of developing relationships with my friends and being able to go ahead and call on those social skills have served me well later in life in business and, you know, in other relationships, other things I've done.
given the amount of agreement. I'm going to skip the rebuttal period. We are past the midway point. We're going to try to squeeze in as many questions as we can. The next question will go to Ms. Roche. Are you satisfied with the current U.S. history curriculum in the county? And if not, how would you improve it?
I must admit, I don't know the history curriculum in Forsyth County, and so I wouldn't know how to improve it. But what we do is, it's not truly, that's not one of the jobs of a board member. The board members create the policy. They pass it on to a very qualified superintendent that we hire, and he in turn passes it on to the curriculum person at central office, and they work with it. They bring in teachers, they develop the curriculum, they have parents involved, they bring in textbooks and now online materials and all that to help develop that curriculum. But I must admit that I do not know the history curriculum in Forsyth County and cannot comment on how to improve it.
Question rolls to Mr. Foley.
What Ms. Roche said.
Mr. Tasos?
I, as far as being, I'm probably among the three of us more familiar with the U.S. history curriculum, as I had a son who just recently went through that, one who's going through it now. As far as the curriculum goes, I think one thing that's tantamount and very important, personally, I use our library. I like to have my hand on a book when I read. I mean, I know we have e-readers and computers where you can read, but I really feel that we're hamstringing some of our kids by not giving them a textbook to really learn and really absorb. And I think as far as the curriculum goes, whatever curriculum is, I think we need to provide textbooks, hard copy textbooks for our kids. And it seems like sometimes those are more difficult to obtain.
The first rebuttal would go to Ms. Roche.
I think the problem we've gotten with having textbooks is that our curriculum is based, we bring things in, like we say, from Google and from here and from there. We develop our curriculum around worldwide information, and there's no textbook out there that says, okay, this is the textbook that we want to teach. So we've really gotten away from textbooks in Forsyth County, I think mainly because of that.
Next rebuttal will go to Mr. Foley. And Ms. Tasos.
Nancy, I understand the value of Google and things that we do, but do we read newspapers in the classroom? I mean, does somebody put a newspaper in somebody's hand and say, hey, here's some articles, read this? Because history is today. We're making history every day. Why not have the kids read out of a newspaper? And getting somebody to read, I learned to read at an early age by reading the sports page. And it's something that I did before I was in school. I think we need to challenge kids with periodicals, with newspapers, and anything that they can get their hands on.
Can I add to that? Yeah, no, there's already been rebuttal time for each of you. There's plenty of rebuttals later that you guys can squeeze additional answers in, and there's a lot of questions on the agenda, and if they can. The next question does go to Mr. Tasos. What is your position on borrowing money for future school construction via issuing municipal bonds?
I know that the former principal at our local elementary school asked me to help with the SPLOS program. And I think if we're smart, we have a good plan. I learned at an early age the 5 P's, and proper preparation prevents poor performance. I think we got to pick our spots where we're going to get funded. I think we have to look at the smartest way to obtain funding for new schools. There's no doubt we need new schools. But I think the other thing we can do is, as much that's going on now, is improve what we have and figure out a way to make what we have bigger. And I don't know what the solution to that is. If I was up here and had all the answers, I'd just go ahead and say, all right, nobody's going to listen to me. I think we have a lot of smart minds in this county who could help improve and help things be better.
Next question, that question now goes to Mr. Foley. What is your position on borrowing money for future school construction via issuing municipal bonds?
Okay, yeah, that I'm not a big fan of, because I don't believe in going into debt unless it's absolutely necessary. So what I would do is, as Mr. Tasos said, is there ways we can spend money wiser, or improve what we got? Sorry about that. Or is there anything in the budget we don't even need? I mean, look at what cuts we may be able to do. So, and just to add on to what Mr. Tasos said earlier about reading, at one teaching job I had before, once a week we always did 15 minutes of silent reading every day, and the kids could read whatever they want, the sports page, or a history book or whatever, and the studies have found that kids actually retain more when they read something that interests them.
The question now goes to Ms. Roche.
It's not necessarily that I believe in bonds, but bonds is the way that we have to go to the community and we have to tell them exactly how much money we are going to ask for in the bonds, and we have to tell them exactly all the projects that we want fulfilled. Because you talk about cutting in the budget or whatever, and maybe adding on whatever, but the M&O budget that's only 11% of our total budget. 89% of our budget is personnel. So we have to have another way other than going from our regular budget to build schools. So, like I say, that's the way that we have to go to the community, we have to get those bonds, and we have to build more schools. If we don't build those schools, then we have to put trailers in. This budget, you're talking millions of dollars worth of trailers, unfortunately, across the county. But if the bond gets voted down, you will still have to be paying for those trailers to be going on all those campuses, because that has to come out of the M&O budget. It cannot come out of, because the bonds won't be there. And we use the SPLOST money. The SPLOST money right now is being used to pay off the bonds that we have. In fact, in next year, by the end of this year, we will have some money available because we will have paid off a couple of the bonds. And by next, I think it's June, we'll, again, don't quote me on all the specific details, I think it's $38 million we'll have available from SPLOST because we will have paid off these bonds. And again, we'll be looking at that very, very carefully. And it will very possibly be going towards land because obviously we're going to need more schools. Again, we're looking for smarter ways and more ideas and, that we can educate these children. But most of our schools are now, say we have 16 being renovated. We've maxed out the media center has to be a certain size. The lunchroom has to be a certain size from the state requirements. And we've pretty much maxed out all our schools after all of these renovations, I believe. Thank you.
The first rebuttal would go to Ms. Tasos.
Yeah, I think looking at bonds and funding it, I think one of the things that it boils down to is a sales job. Because I don't know of too many parents who say, well, we don't want better schools. But I think one of the things that we have to do is have somebody share our vision of what the money's going to go for and what the extra bond funds will go for. And I think if you have something that makes sense and you show somebody what this is going to go for and it has solid logic, I think you have a lot easier time getting parents and buy in.
Mr. Foley, can you rebuttal Ms. Roche?
Given that we are at 8:15, there will be closing statements coming up soon and also the opportunity for each candidate to ask each other a question. I will make this the last question of the evening, after which point you guys will be able to ask your questions to one another, and then after that we'll do the closing statements. And the question goes to Mr. Foley. It's a little, somewhat long one. What is your position regarding instituting a 0.25% or 0.25% county sales tax to fund the school budget so that they can refuse future state funding to eliminate Common Core?
Something I'd be willing to take a look at.
Church. And reread it. What is your position regarding instituting a 0.25% or in other words a 0.25% county sales tax to fund the school budget and refuse future state funding so that they can eliminate Common Core?
I'm not sure that would really all add up. First of all, sales tax is so, when the economy goes down, people aren't out there buying things like they usually do. They're not buying their cars and new sofas and new couches and everything like I say, in their homes, they cut back on their own budget, and so when the sales tax goes down, all of a sudden we don't have that 0.25% sales tax anymore. So, and to pay the state not for us to have to use Common Core, I'm not sure, legally, I'm not sure we'd be able to do something like that. It just sounds like a very kind of convoluted question, and I don't see that really working in the long run at all.
Same question to Mr. Tasos.
I think that trying to add a sales tax to eliminate something that I think people are, for the most part, are against, I think that is kind of convoluted. And I'm not sure those numbers would add up either. I know that anybody tells me, hey, you know what, our sales tax is up, then what am I getting? What's in it for me? And I think one of the things, anytime anybody hears sales tax, wait a minute, I don't have enough money as it is, so I'm not really in favor of that. Maybe I'll go to another county or another state and buy something. Now, I think one of the things we can do, again, is figure out a way where we can be more effective. And I think that's what we need to do.
We are now moving into the stage of the debate where each candidate will have an opportunity to ask the other candidates a question. The first question will go to Ms. Roche. You can ask. You ask either one or both, but they'll both have an opportunity to answer.
Okay. Let me see. I was going to ask you something more detailed, but that's probably not very fair because it's since I've been on the board, I know like we have our students pass to success, which is called the learner profile. But unfortunately, like I say, to comment on that, you would have to be a little more involved. So I will take that off the board and maybe just ask you the question of what do you feel is the biggest contribution you could make if you were elected to the Board of Education? To either one, to both of you.
I'll start with Mr. Foley to answer and then we'll just keep it simple.
Okay. Well, as I said earlier, I've been a teacher and a coach for 10 years. So just having seen firsthand what goes on, I just think the experience I bring is my biggest contribution.
Mr. Tasos?
I think one of the things that I bring is a lack of time in the education system. I think one of the things, and like I said, Nancy, 2001 is a long time, and I salute you for what you've done. You know, there's nothing wrong with getting a fresh set of eyes on something and a new perspective, and that's what I would bring. I'm passionate about our schools, and you know, really, the reason I'm passionate is I've had kids go through it. And I know how good our school system is. And I know that by having fresh ideas and new ideas, I think that's one way we can be more effective and make a good school district even better. And that's one of the things that I want to do. I want to make a difference. The other thing I want to tell you is, you know, one of the biggest things, we talked about the calendar. I'll tell you right now, I'm not a politician. And I've never been in politics. I told somebody the last office I ran for, along with Grand Knight at our church and for Knights of Columbus, I think was senior class president, and I lost there. So I'm not gonna tell you that I'm a politician, but I do think I have some good ideas. I think I have some good business sense. I have some practical sense of just having children who are now still even going through the school. And one thing, I'm going to make a commitment. I'm not going to make this a lifelong avocation. I think one of the things we do when we have career politicians is they get too comfortable and ensconced in a position. And one of the things that we need to do is we need to have, like I said, term limits. And by golly, I get in here, I'm not looking to make this I'm looking to make this 8 years. I'm here in 4 years, and I'm going to turn it over to somebody who's even going to be better than I was. Thank you.
The next opportunity to ask a question goes to Mr. Foley.
I can't think of any, but thanks though.
The final opportunity to ask a question to the fellow candidates is going to go to Mr. Tasos.
I've talked about this. I've talked about this several times up here, and I'm going to ask Ms. Roche. Because obviously, and no offense, I mean, she obviously has the experience. Why are you seeking a fourth term or a fifth term? Fifth term. Why are you doing that? And one of the questions that I have is how would you be as passionate in your fifth term as you were in your first term?
I'm good so far, but I knew I'd get emotional at some time. I haven't lost my passion for education, believe me. I lost my husband last year. It was a real tough year, and I was going to have to make that decision. If he could hang in there, was I going to be able to hang in on the Board of Education? Because I couldn't give back to the board like I wanted to last year. I really couldn't. But this year, unfortunately, he has passed away. I also lost my mom in December, and I feel right now it's going to just fill my emptiness, and it's really good. I will get that. I have the passion. I really do. I really feel like I've been visionary. I've been there. I've been a leader. I think you could ask a lot of the people, the parents, the people in the school system that I've been there. I truly have been a leader. I've had new ideas. I think I'll be researching. I think I'll be finding more new ideas. And I really hope you'll have the confidence in me to continue to serve on the Board of Education, because I say I don't feel my passion is gone. Thank you.
And Mr. Foley does have the opportunity to answer that question. We have reached the end of the evening. It's 8:22. There is time for each candidate to give their 2-minute closing statements. The first closing statement, I'll just tell you in order, it'll go to Mr. Foley, then to Mr. Tasos, and then the final closing statement will go to Ms. Roche. Mr. Foley.
Okay, I just want to thank you again, Brad, for moderating. I want to thank Mr. Tasos and Ms. Roche for discussion up here. I enjoyed it. So. As I said in the beginning, I was a teacher and a coach for 10 years, so I bring that perspective to the office. My priorities work with the Board of the Board of Commissioners, and let them know the impact and where the overdevelopment is really affecting the county, and give the teachers and parents more say in the curriculum, and also free up teachers to focus on their jobs more. Instead of all this redundant paperwork and redundant testing. And my pledge is to serve one term, two at the most. And once again, my name is Kevin Foley. I ask you to vote on May 24th. Thank you.
Mr. Tasos?
Thank you very much for the opportunity. Thank you for moderating, Kevin and Nancy. Thank you. And Nancy, let me say, I'm sorry for your loss, because I've gone through that, and it's not the loss of the spouse, but the loss of parents. I think that one of the things that we have, when I said get new ideas and new people, new perspective, that's not to say the people who were formerly in the position wouldn't be an asset. Nancy, should I win this election and should I be selected, I'm going to call on you. I'm going to call on people who have served on this board, because, you know, like I said, I don't have all the answers. This will be a new position for me. And I want to make sure, I want to mine the people who have been in this position and see what worked for them and maybe what didn't work, because they'll have great perspective. Now, what I want to do is I want to make a difference. I want to let people know who are thinking of running for office that, yes, you can run for office as a first-timer, even if you don't have experience, because there is a wealth of knowledge. There are so many assets in this county, whether it be in business, whether it be in elected officials. You know, I think one of the things we don't mind enough is all the successful business people in this county. How do we get access to them? How do our students get access? They want to go into business, we need to come up with something where business people can interact better with our students. My name is Mike Tasos, and I've lived in Forsyth County since 1994, and I lived in Georgia since 1991. Never thought I'd stay that long, but I sure am glad I did. And I would appreciate your support, and tell your friends to support me too. Thank you.
And the final closing statement will go to Ms. Roche.
Again, I'd like to thank the Republican Party for hosting this evening, and thank you for being here this evening. And if I do win re-election, I look forward to you bringing forth some of your ideas and your ideas to make things even better, because I'll be looking for things like that. We're in our final year of our strategic plan. It's called Our Path to Greatness. So this fall and next year we'll be developing a new one. So we look forward to the community's ideas of what needs to change and how do we keep striving to make things better. Our school system has a very strong belief system. We believe that trust among all stakeholders is vital, and that a school-community partnership is important, or we're not going to be successful. We have the Partners in Education. We've reached out to so many businesses. We have a wonderful program going with our partners. We also believe that expectations influence accomplishments and that everyone has the capacity to learn. In Forsyth, we know that our fast growth is challenging, but we also believe that change creates opportunity. Once we open a new school, we have to have a new principal. That means assistant principals can become new principals, and teachers become assistant principals. So there's an awful lot of opportunity with our growth. We also believe that high-performing leadership makes visions reality. I hope you will give me the opportunity to serve on the Forsyth County Board of Education for another term so I can continue to be a part of that success. Please vote for the vision, the experience, and my proven leadership when you cast your votes on May 24th or earlier, because it starts next Monday, early voting. So please see me on Facebook at Vote Nancy Roche with any questions or concerns, and thank you to everyone for being here this evening.
And that concludes our debate. I'd like to thank our participants.
Thank you to all our candidates. And let's give our candidates one more round of applause for coming out. One thing to note, and Nancy made this comment, early voting does start next Monday, so mark that on your calendar. You can find those locations online through the Forsyth County government's website. Also, if the last day to register to vote is tomorrow, if you're not registered to vote by if you're not registered to vote, you have until tomorrow evening to register and be ready for the main primary. So thank you all for coming out, and we'll be back here on this Wednesday, April 27th at 5:30. Again at 5:30 for the corner debate, and then Sheriff will start at 7 p.m. Thank y'all so much.
I need a car, but it doesn't. Because they all went to a man's station.